2 Thessalonians, chapter number 2, I'd like to speak to you on the place of the Holy Spirit, of the ministry of the Holy Spirit, after the church is raptured out of the earth and during the time of the tribulation period. Now, that's a big subject. Actually, I'm not going to preach on a subject necessarily. I would like to expound the second chapter of 2 Thessalonians with the ministry of the Holy Spirit basically upon my heart. And the Holy Spirit is very clearly set forth in this second chapter. I believe that a triune God is concerned about and interested in the second coming of our Lord. You remember how in Acts 1, the angels of the Lord said, this same Jesus. So that involves the Son of God in the second advent, when Jesus comes again. And then, of course, in the plan of God and the economy of God, there is to be a second advent. There was the first advent of the coming of our Lord in God's program 2,000 years ago. From the foundation of the world, you and I believe that God planned to send his only begotten Son, not an angel, not human, from among Adam's race, but his only begotten Son was ordained of God and foreordained of God from the foundation of the world to come the first time to give his life a ransom for many. Now, the same God so foreordains the second advent. The second advent will be the return of Jesus, this same Jesus, whom you've seen go away, shall so come in like manner. Now, what will be the relationship of the Holy Spirit in these matters of the second coming of our Lord? We saw something about the second coming of Jesus in our Sunday school lesson a moment ago in 2 Peter chapter number 3. He is coming again, a very clear Bible a reality is the second advent of our Lord. I think sometimes we grow accustomed to hearing sermons on the second coming, and it hadn't really dawned upon us the imminent return and the close return, the immediate return of our Lord and our Savior. I would that it could grip my soul of the soon coming of our Lord to the degree that I'd be watching for him every day like Elisha, who walked with his head turned toward the sky, having crossed Jordan River, with the promise, if you see me where I go up, you can have a double portion of the Holy Spirit. Now, you and I ought so fervently watch and expect and look for the second coming of our Lord. In such a time as you think not, that is, the world think not, the Son of Man cometh. And if there was a time when the world is thinking not, when the world is scoffing at the very idea, when the world is ignoring the truth of the second Adventist man. And that within itself is an indication of the soon return of Jesus to this earth. When men are saying peace and safety, then cometh sudden destruction upon them as travail upon a woman with child. There's never been a generation so subjected to a barrage of peace talk as your generation and mine. I admire the leaders of the nation to the earth as they seek to find the peace. And I'm not a pessimist. I am a realist. I'm a Bible believer. And I can't find in the Bible that there's going to be an lasting peace upon this earth until our Lord sets it up in the millennium when he comes again the second time. And you're a little bit naive to expect a peace in the Middle East. A few days ago at Camp David, all the world is saying maybe it's at the threshold. And now here we are just 30 days later, and the thing is bogged down. Looks like, oh, let's start all over again. If President Carter had been a premillennial Bible believer, if he'd gotten his information from the scriptures, as you and I get ours, he wouldn't have put a great deal of stock in his peace programs to begin with. There's not going to be any peace in the Middle East. Now, wait a minute, preacher. Wait, you ought not to say that. For my soul, I'm not a politician. You see, I'm a preacher. I don't deal with politics and political science. I deal with theology. And I believe that in theology, there is an element of prophecy. I don't think all theology is prophecy, but a great part of theology, and that's my field, is prophecy, having to do with things to come. And I'd not be much of a student of theology if I ignored the second advent of our Lord. And you're not much of a student of theology if you ignore the second coming of our Lord either. Now, I say if President Carter had been a premillennial Bible believer and accepted what the Bible says about the Middle East, then he'd not be preparing or trying to work out some peace program, not necessarily. Now, I think a man ought to be for peace, and I commend him for being for peace. I'm for peace also, but I'm also for believing the Bible. And there has not been any peace between the Jews and Arabs since Abraham sent Hagar away. And there won't be any. There won't be any. The Bible says there won't be any. They're at each other's throat, have been all these years, and they are now, and they will be. And when men say peace and safety, then comes sudden destruction. That's one of the signs of the second coming of our Lord. All this peace activity is a sign that soon he's coming back to this earth the second time. Now, I don't mean that to be a note of pessimism, and I'm not defeated, not at all. Any man that believes in the second coming of our Lord could be nothing but an optimist. And I am an optimist. The brightest days are just ahead for God's people that they've ever enjoyed in their lifetime. They're born again. In fact, just ahead for me and you is King Jesus and his second advent and the throne of David and a millennium of 1,000 years when the knowledge of God shall cover the earth like the waters cover the sea. When the lion and the lamb shall lie down together. When the lion shall eat straw like an oxen. When the old serpent will lose his bite. When a child shall play with a serpent and not be harmed. When none shall say, I am sick. We won't need Kennedy's program then. No. He's got a health program he's trying to sell to the American people that'll cost billions. But when Jesus comes back, none shall say, I am sick. We're just ahead. Just ahead of us is the day when the hospitals are going to close up. Wait a minute, preacher. You're crazy. That's right. Maybe I am inside of the world, but I'm a believer. The time's coming, the hospital's going to close up, and doctors are going to have to be retrained. Nurses have to be retrained. Childbirth won't be painful and travail like it is now. Infant mortality will almost be a thing of the past. Oh, we're on the threshold of something wonderful. Every man will sit beneath his own vine. And they're going to beat the influence of warfare into puny hooks instead of war no more. Westport Academy will close its doors. The Naval Academy in Pensacola will go out of business. The Air Force will be grounded. The atomic bombs will be defused. And the armies will be disbanded. Wait a minute, preacher. Wait a minute. You live in a world of fantasy. Now, wait a minute. I'm a Bible believer. Everything I've said, I find in the book. Now, the key to all of that is the second coming of Jesus Christ, my Lord. But he's not coming again. I've heard that all my lifetime. Well, our Sunday school lesson a while ago said that in the last time scoffers would come, so you are a fulfillment of Bible prophecy. I'm not going to scoff at it. I'm going to believe it. Well, what if he doesn't come? Well, I've lost nothing because I'm going to die and you're going to die. If I die looking for a second coming, I'm no worse off, that's for sure. And it could well be that he might come while I'm watching. And at least I won't be surprised. I'm going to be expecting it. When I hear the trumpet, I'll know exactly what that is. I won't have to dial your phone number and ask you. I'll know what it is. I've been waiting for it for a long time. Amen. Second coming. And that's going to be a day when the Jew and the Arab will be at peace, but there won't be any peace until that happens. In fact, I can remember just a little bit about World War No. 1. I can remember the soldiers coming home to Camp Jackson in World War No. 1 in 1918. I can faintly remember that in my mind. And then I can well remember, of course, all the days of World War No. 2. I'll never forget Pearl Harbor. That's one Sunday morning that's indelibly imprinted upon my mind. When I went to Sunday school that day, not having TVs and not having radios accessible as we do now, somebody at Sunday school told us about Pearl Harbor that Sunday morning, December the 7th, 1941. That's almost as fresh as yesterday to me. And I remember well the Korean conflict when our boys fought the communists in North and South Korea. Then I remember all the days of the Vietnam campaign and all the heartaches and tragedies that came along with the Vietnam problem. And now I'm waiting for World War No. 3. But wait a minute. Why wait for another war? Because the Bible says that Gog and Magog is going to come down against the land of them all villages to take a spoil and take a prey. And that's never happened. And that's Ezekiel 38 and 39. 3 is going to be the invasion by the northern armies of the little state of Israel. He's coming down to take a spoil of oil and to take a prey of oil. I heard on the radio this morning before I came to church that Russia had put the world on notice that there would be no intervention in Iran. Iran borders Russia on the south. And Russia has her eye, as sure as you are born, she's got her eye on a takeover in the most friendly nation, oil nation in the world to America, the nation of Iran. And she's warning America and other nations, you better play hands off, to use the very vernacular of the newsman used today. Hands off. And when Russia says hands off to the other nation, that means my hand is upon that nation. And Russia's going to take over Iran as sure as you're born. And then later on, she's coming right on down further south. Iran is directly in the path from the north. She's coming further south into the land of unwalled villages to take a spoil and to take a prey. That's World War number 3. And that war closed out with the dreadful Battle of Armageddon described in Revelation 16 and Revelation 19. Now, that's in the Bible. Now, I'm not being a pessimist to believe the Bible. And you're not being a pessimist to believe the Bible. I just finished talking to you a moment ago about the most optimistic future you've ever heard of in your lifetime. But at the same time, before those days come, those good days come, a dreadful worldwide conflict of great magnitude in Europe when Gog and Magog come down against the land of the unwalled villages. Now let's look at these verses in relation to the ministry of the Holy Spirit in particular and the time of the second coming of our Lord. Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together unto Him. Now they happen at the one and same time. When Jesus comes again, that's when we are gathered together unto Him. That's the rapture. This is Paul's way of calling the rapture. This is Paul's way of announcing the resurrection. Our gathering together unto Him. Now if I'd been writing that verse, I expect I would have said rapture or I would have said resurrection. But Paul's terminology is rather interesting, rather unique, rather different, but it means exactly the same thing. I beseech you by two great truths. First, by the coming again of our Lord Jesus Christ. Second, and by our gathering together unto Him. That's the second advent in the resurrection and the rapture. I beseech you that ye be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand. Let no man deceive you by any means. For that day, the day of Christ, the day of the second coming, we saw that terminology in our Sunday school lesson today in 2 Peter chapter number 3, the day of the Lord. The day of the Lord is the second advent. We saw in our lesson in Sunday school, Peter mentioned the last days. In the last days, this know also in the last days. Last days, Paul used the same terminology in 1 Peter chapter number 3, 1 Timothy chapter number 3, that Peter used in 2 Peter chapter number 3. The last days, I believe, to be the days in which we now live. And that's the day of the second coming, the last days, the day of the Lord. Let no man deceive you by any means. Now, evidently from the things that Paul is saying, in 2 Thessalonians 2, there had been some with perverted ideas about the second coming who set out to trouble the Thessalonian believer. And one of the things that they had evidently done was to remind the Thessalonian believers that the resurrection was already past and that the second coming of our Lord in actuality had already happened. And they'd been upset and troubled in spirit and by word and by letter in verse number 2. As that the day of Christ is at hand, or already come. And then Paul said, don't let nobody deceive you. And I think right at this particular point, we ought to be very careful that we know the truth about the second coming of our Lord. not to be deceived by any ideas or wild fantasies about what the second coming is all about, or wild imaginations. But scripturally, we need to know what the Bible teaches in relation to the second coming. Now, let no man deceive you by any means, for or because that day of the Lord, that last day, shall not come, except two things take place in verse number 3, except there come a falling away first, and second, except the man of sin be revealed, who is the son of hell, the son of the devil, the son of perdition. Now, these two things must transpire before the day of the Lord and the second coming of our Savior. Now, the first of those things is called a falling away first. And that's the King James translation of the word apostasy. The Greek word apostasy means to fall away. Now, there's some who are holding that the word apostasy is a reference to the rapture. And they call the rapture a falling away when the people of God are lifted out of the earth and carried to meet Jesus in clouds. I don't see that. The apostasy is always related to religion in the Bible and has no relationship to the second coming as far as the rapture is concerned. The word apostasy is a religious word, and it refers to organized religion falling away from the faith once delivered unto the saints of God. Now, I submit to you, we now live in the day of the fulfillment of that prophecy. And it's going to continue to be fulfilled until the second advent of our Lord. If you have the idea that every church that has its steeple turned towards the sky is true to the Bible, then you've been deluded and given a strong delusion. I would that was so, but it's not so. There are many churches in our day that are departed from the ancient landmarks that our fathers have set. And you will not leave the city of Greenville to find churches that will deny the very one that bought them in his own blood and deny the scriptures that they are inspired of God. You'd find institutions in our city that would deny the verbal inspiration of the Holy Scriptures and deny that this Bible is the very word of God. That's apostasy. Apostasy. When men have no conviction, when men have no doctrine, when men stand for nothing. Well, Dr. Bob Jones, you say if a man doesn't stand for something, he'll fall for anything. And that's exactly right. If a man doesn't have some doctrine, he'll fall for anything, anybody that comes along. Now, you and I are to build our faith upon doctrine. But that very principle is frowned upon in our day. And there's a movement in our day away from doctrine to what men call love. I saw that movement go so far the other day with a motto that said, love is God. Now, that's not so. That's idolatry. Love is not God. Now, God is love, but that's only one attribute of God. God is also grace, and God is also kindness. God is also judgment. God is also a heavenly Father. God is also the Father of our Lord Jesus. He's also love, no doubt about that, but love is not God. They twisted that up. They thought that sounded good, but actually that's idolatry. You bow down to the shrine of love, you've departed from the one true and living God. No, love is not God. Now, God is love in one attribute. He's many other things also. He's a consuming fire. He's my advocate. He's my mediator. He's my eternal high priest. He's love, but love is not God. And don't you be swept off your feet by this phraseology and these great swelling words by the liberals and the ecumenists in our day. Don't do that. I say to you that any man that will deny the verbal inspiration of the Bible is an apostate. Any man that will deny the virgin birth of our Lord is an apostate. Any man that will deny the premillennial second coming of our Lord is an apostate. Any man that will deny the fact of perdition or hell is an apostate. Any man that will deny the person of the devil is an apostate. Any man that will deny that Jesus is God's only begotten Son who died vicariously upon the cross is an apostate. They're not Bible believers at all. No. Now, Paul said, let no man deceive you. The day of the Lord will not come except the cover falling away. And that day has come. And then second, except the man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. The man of sin is the Antichrist. I'm saying to you that simultaneously with the resurrection and the rapture is the revelation of the Antichrist. They happen at the same moment, maybe just a bit before or soon after, but at the same moment, the revelation of the Antichrist. I'm saying to you, Jesus cannot come as a thief in the night in the rapture except the Antichrist be on hand. Did you get that now? The prophecy of the Bible demands that when Jesus come, the man of sin be ready to be revealed. Now, the man of sin, we'll see a bit later, comes according to the working of the devil and in the program of the devil. But God's going to see to it that that program is right ready when the time is right. And so when the resurrection takes place and the rapture takes place, the devil's counterfeit is ready to be revealed. And so the day of the Lord cannot come except there come a falling away. Second, except the man of sin be revealed, who is the son of hell, the son of perdition. Now, about this man of sin in verse 4, look at it in your Bible now. About him I read, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God. And it goes so far as demanded to be worshipped, so that he as God, claiming to be God, showing himself that he's God, receiving worship as God, sitteth in the temple of God and receiving the worship of the people, showing himself and declaring himself to be God. That's the Antichrist. He's a satanic incarnated individual, pruned, groomed, and prepared by the devil for the moment of his revelation, as recorded in these verses, whose coming is after the working of Satan. And the devil's masterpiece will be the man of sin, the son of perdition. Now Paul goes on to say, remember you not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things? Which is to say that when Paul was in Thessalonica, and did he not spend many months in Thessalonica? He sure did. He founded the church there and lingered a long time. Remember how he started out in Thessalonica in the synagogue, and they ran him out of the synagogue, and he went next door to the house of a man named Jason and continued to preach next door to the synagogue in Thessalonica, in the house of Jason. But it didn't long until they ran him away from there. But he founded the church and left behind the Thessalonian church. And no doubt verse 5 is a reminder that while Paul was in Thessalonica, he oftentimes preached the doctrine of the second coming. Remember you not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things? Line upon line, precept upon precept, I told you these things. Now actually, that's my burden and that's my responsibility. This is my duty. I don't know that I spend too much time dealing with the general theme of the second coming. I doubt if I do. One day I'll be gone. And when I'm gone, I want you to remember that while I was yet with you, I told you these things. I may not live to see the second coming of our Lord, but when my time of departure arrives, I want this congregation to be so indoctrinated, if any scoffer ever stands up in this pulpit and mock at the second coming of Christ, you stand up and tell him, shut up, because we've been instructed. And that's why I preach as I do. And that's exactly what Paul says in verse number 5. Remember you not that while I was yet with you, I told you these things. I brought them to you line upon line and precept upon precept. And now you know what withholdeth that he might reveal, that he might be revealed in his time. Now this was a reference to the Holy Spirit, verses 6 and 7. Now watch verse number 7. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Now may I remind you that the climax of the mystery of iniquity is the revelation of the Antichrist. The Antichrist will be the crowning work of the devil, Lucifer, who was cast out of heaven when he rebelled against the Almighty. All the program of the mystery of iniquity from the very inception of a wicked thought by the devil, before he was cast out of heaven, is to be climaxed by this incarnated individual, the man of sin. And many Bible students, really and confidently believe that Judas Iscariot will be that incarnated individual. Now, I'm not going to make that as a dogmatic statement, but it's worthy of some thought. Judas, like the man of sin, is called the son of perdition. The only two persons in the Bible called the son of perdition is Judas Iscariot and the counterfeit Messiah, the man of sin, in this particular chapter. And it could well be that Judas so gave himself to the devil until the devil will reincarnate himself in Judas Iscariot. And the Judas will come again, incarnate himself in Judas Iscariot. And the Judas will come again and be the Antichrist. That's simply a word. Take it what it's worth and study it out for yourself. But one thing for sure, the crowning word of all the mystery of iniquity, and that's a reference to the entire program of the devil, from the beginning until his end. The crowning work of the devil is the revelation of the man of sin, the Antichrist. Now watch what it says in verse 7. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. Now that verse will be a little difficult for the average casual reader to understand without a commentary. He, only he who now letteth, without any doubt, is a reference to the Holy Spirit. And I began a moment ago reminding you that I was going to try to preach to you a moment about the ministry of the Spirit of God in relation to the tribulation and the second coming of our Lord. He who now letteth will continue to let until he be taken out of the way. Now, some feel that he who now letteth is a reference to the church. But I can't see that. I'm aware of the fact that the church indeed lifts a standard and does lift a standard against the devil. I'm so proud for the church. I'm so glad for the church. We're a pillar of faith. We're like a torch, a city set on a hill that cannot be hid. And the church, no doubt, does lift the standard. But the church is not in mind in verse number 7. No, I don't think so. Others feel that it's the preaching of the gospel, and that one day the preaching of the gospel will cease. No, I don't think so. The preaching of the gospel, as we now preach it, will cease. But in the tribulation, another gospel, the everlasting gospel, will be preached. And in the millennium, an everlasting gospel will be preached, you see. God will never allow a day in this earth without a gospel message. Now, he who now letteth, without any doubt, as far as I'm concerned, is a reference to the Holy Spirit of God, God's executive in the earth today. God with us now. The Holy Spirit is a part of a triune God. The Holy Spirit, I remind you, is as real as the Holy Son. The Holy Spirit is as real as the Holy Father. You and I are Trinitarians in that we believe in a triune God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, three in one. I cannot explain that. No man can explain that. There are some naive people who insist on what they call Jesus only, and by their so doing, they deny the personality of the Holy Spirit. The Church of Christ, the Carmelites, believe that the Holy Spirit is the Bible. They deny the personality of the Holy Spirit. Baptists don't do that. Some Pentecostal groups deny the Father and deny the Spirit and preach what they call Jesus only. And they demand that people be baptized in Jesus' name only. I don't believe that. We're a baptized convert in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. That's the Bible formula. We are Trinitarian. In that degree, man is made in the image of God. I'm a Trinity. I'm body, I'm soul, I'm spirit. And that's how man is made in the image of God. I don't think any of us look like God. I wouldn't think so at all. I think we're like God in that God is a Trinity, and so is man a Trinity. I'm more than just an animal. Now, an animal, a dog, a horse, has no soul, has no spirit. Or they have a fleshly spirit, but no eternal spirit. The dog, an animal, has life, but no eternal spirit.
But a human being has a soul. And the soul of man is as real as his body. Sure. And in that way, man is different from the animal kingdom. Because animals are not Trinitarian. Man is a Trinity. Body, soul, and spirit. And that's how we're made in the image of God. Now, he who now letteth is a reference to the blessed Holy Spirit of God, who works as God's chief executive in this world. And I want to remind you that the program of the mystery of iniquity progresses only as the Spirit of God permits the mystery of iniquity to come to a climax. And if the devil gets a little bit too hurried, the Holy Spirit puts a check on it. The Holy Spirit restrains him. If the devil becomes a little bit too bold, the Holy Spirit restrains him. He who now letteth. The word let we will not use in our day. It's an old English word that we will not use in this verse. Actually, the verse says, he who now hinders will continue to hinder the mystery of iniquity until the time is right and until he's taken out of the way. Which is to say that the Holy Spirit of God will go out of the earth when the church goes out of the earth. In the rapture, the Spirit goes out with you and I, in that he shall present the church to the waiting bridegroom in the mighty rapture of the church, you see. Now the typology, Genesis 24, when Eliezer, the servant of Abraham, sought for a bride for Isaac. Eliezer's name is not given in that chapter, by the way. He's a type of the Holy Spirit. But elsewhere we find his name to be Eliezer. And the name of Eliezer means God the Helper. That fits the Holy Spirit like a glove, doesn't it? He's the comforter. He's the helper. He's the guide. He's the teacher. The Holy Spirit is the indweller. Eliezer, in Genesis 24, is the type of the Spirit. He finally had his fleece wet, and Rebekah proved to be the bride of Isaac, the son born miraculously. Isaac is the type of Christ, and Abraham the type of God. And Eliezer said to the bride, wilt thou go? And that bride, having not seen, having only heard, said, I will go. And that servant sat on an extra camel, and that very night left the house of Bethuel and started back of Abraham's tent with an extra member of his party, the bride. And I'd like to remind you that 2,000 years ago, God the Helper, whom we know to be the blessed Holy Spirit of God, came down into this earth to seek for a bride for God's only begotten Son, the Lord Jesus. And one day he knocked at my heart's door and said, I want to tell you a story, young man. And he told me about a great God, the great creator of the universe, who from the stars from his fingertips, and who's rich in houses and lands and silver and gold, who owns the cattle upon a thousand hills and all the gold in those hills, who has an only begotten Son that was born miraculously, without sin, without guile, the lovely Savior about whom we sing. And I said as a lad, with my mouth wide open, drinking in the story of another world. And after the story was told to me, that servant said, wilt thou go? And having not seen, I, like Rebecca, said, I will go. At that moment he put the seal of the blessed Spirit of God in my soul. He indwelt my body like Eliezer reached his hand into the treasure chest and took out a beautiful bracelet and said, Rebecca, give me your arm. And she held her arm out and he put that bracelet on the arm of Rebecca. At the moment she received it, she had a part of heaven in her soul. She had the foretaste of a lot more to come. She had a little bit of heaven right there she could feel and look at. And so when I was converted by the grace of God, God slipped me the Holy Spirit. And he said, there's a lot more to come. But this is a token and this is a seal until the inheritance of the possession becomes a reality. And then I started the journey, and I've been traveling now through many dangers, toils, and snares for a long, long time. And sometimes I feel like I can't trudge on any longer. But he keeps me going because he's the comforter. And sometimes the way is dangerous, and the lions lurk on the pathway, and the devil says, I'll get you around the next curve. But I look to my leader. I look to my God. You say, oh, blessed Spirit of God, guide me and direct me around that curve, and he does. And one day I'm going to climb the last mountain top. And when Eliezer and that bride climbed that last mountain top in Genesis 24, and Rebecca saw that lovely meadow, a picture of eternity, she saw a man see the edge of the field at eventide meditating. And when she saw that man, she said to the servant, who is that man? And he proudly squared his shoulders and said, that's my master's son, Isaac. He's the bridegroom. One day I'm going to top the last mountain and see the valley of eternity, and I'm going to see the Prince of Glory, his name is Jesus, sitting at the edge of the field, waiting for the Holy Spirit to bring the bride. He knows the Holy Spirit's been gone 2,000 years away from heaven, and he knows who the Holy Spirit's going to bring when he returns. And I shall say to the blessed Spirit, who is that? And the Spirit of God will then present me to the Holy Son. And Isaac took Rebecca and carried her into the tent of Abraham, and she was his wife. And when that happens to me, he's going to carry me into the holy city, the New Jerusalem, and I'll be his bride forever and forever and forever. Now that's the Holy Spirit. Now he's going to be taken out of this world when we go. And when he's taken out, then there'll be nothing to hinder the devil. There will be no power to restrain the devil when he leaves. And that's when the man of sin is to be revealed. But I mark you, until the Holy Spirit is taken out, you and me haven't got a great deal to worry about. Because greater are they that be with us than they that be with them. I'd like for the devil to hear that. I wish I could shout it into his ears. You're a roaring lion, you devil. But I want you to know that I found out that your sting has been removed. And you're more of a roar than anything else. You make a lot of noise, but you don't have any power. Your power's been broken. And your power's broken by my Lord and my Savior when he walked out of that grave 2,000 years ago. And said, fear not. I'm he that was alive and was dead and am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and of hell. Fear not! So I'm not going to be afraid. Though the night's alone, and the mountains are perilous, and though the robbers lurk, and though the devil threatens, and the devil harasses and intimidates, I'm not going to be afraid. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Let the covenant stretch. Let the second threat. Let the world go crazy. Let sinners become bold in their rebellion. Whatever might befall, as long as the Spirit of God is with us, we have the advantage. One with us that's able to keep that which we've committed unto him against that day. I have the foretaste. I've got the seal. And the seal's on the inside of me, brother. And the old devil has to recognize it, whether he wants to or not. But one day, when the bride is finished and the rapture takes place, then the dead are going to get up and the living are going to be caught up. And the Holy Spirit's going to lead us out. And we're going to leave this world. Did you hear what I said? Now, don't tell anybody I said that. Somebody might seem as a psychiatrist. But we're going to leave this world. I mean, we're going to leave this world without God. Wait a minute, preacher. You are crazy. No, we're going to leave this world without dying. We're going to leave this world without saying goodbye. We're going to leave this world with a company of the redeemed. Led up by the blessed Holy Spirit of God, who found me and brought me to the Savior and saved me and sealed me and has guided me and taught me and covered me all these years. Now, when he goes, now look at verse 8. Only he who now hinders will continue to hinder until he be taken out of the way. And the he of verse 7 could refer only to the Holy Spirit. Now when he goes, and he goes with the church, he presents the church to the waiting bridegroom. Then, not until, but then, when the church is gone, when the Holy Spirit is gone, when the salt is gone, when the light is gone, When the time is right, then shall that wicked be revealed. That's the Antichrist, the wicked one. And this son of perdition, he calls in verse number 3, cannot be revealed until the time for his revelation. He can't guarantee the covenant. He can't confirm the covenant until his time is right. Nothing until God gives the signal. Amen. Isn't that wonderful? All your devils working in the shop. He's getting the man of sin ready. He's working on the mystery of iniquity, and he's been working on the mystery of iniquity ever since he was cast out of heaven. But he can only go so far. And if he goes one step further than so far, God restrains him. The Holy Spirit restrains him. The Holy Spirit hinders him and says, wait a minute, no further right now, no further right now. Go on by. Holy Spirit, he's the great executive in this world. You know, I think sometimes too much emphasis is placed on what some people call demons. In fact, the word demon is not in your Bible. Why don't you quit saying demon? Why don't you say what the King James Bible says, devil? I quit using the word demon. They're devils, they're devils. And then there's one father, a whole crowd of them, he's Satan, the deceiver, Lucifer, the devil. And that's what the Bible calls him. But I don't know, but what, it might be a little unwise to place too much emphasis on the devil. I'd like you to know that I shall not, that greater things would be with us. Amen, buddy. How are you going to keep God's people when you've got God tabernacling in the bodies of the last one? How are you going to keep it from the grave when the Spirit of God knows the spot? When he hovers above that grave until the resurrection, he'll get us up. Romans 8:22. He'll get us out of the grave. The same Spirit that resurrected Christ Jesus shall also quicken your mortal body. How in the world can you defeat a program like that? God's the victor. The devil is an accuser. The devil is a liar. The devil is a deceiver. You and I have every right in the world to be optimistic and be victorious because of this great executive, the blessed Spirit of God that abides with us right now. I'd like to remind you, the Spirit doesn't come and go. I'm asking the Holy Spirit, thank you, to get back to heaven and greet Gabriel. Wouldn't you think so? Father, the Holy Spirit made Gabriel. Right? The Holy Father, the Holy Son, the Holy Spirit made Gabriel. I imagine the Holy Spirit would like to get back to heaven and hear the angel choir sing another time. He left the God, he is God who made the angel choir. Holy Spirit. Father, the Holy Spirit hadn't had his foot in heaven in 2,000 years. Been down here on the earth, been living in your body, helping me and you when we pray, comforting me and you when our hearts are open, teaching me and you the word of God, standing outside when we give a witness and try to preach, filling our souls when we sing. He said, do so, minding God's truth, until he hadn't had time to go home for 2,000 years. Don't you guess the Holy Spirit be anxious to go back home? But be assured he'll not go home until he tells Rebecca with it. Rebecca will go home with him. And he will stay here until last one of the saved. And secure. And careful. And he'll carry us home, not piecemeal, but in a body complete with our brilliant sorrow. Oh, amen. Oh, devil. You just have to take it. Not a thing you can do about it. You just have to take it. You can't do a thing until he who now let it is taken out of the way. Oh, amen, brethren. That's enough to make you want to say glory to God. Oh, devil. Bothers you, bothers me.
when my Bible tells me that the Holy Spirit is the chief executive and not the devil?
The Holy Spirit is the chief executive. And I'm glad I know that. He's God's word is in our day. He said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. Hold my horses, boy, follow me down.
Preach up! You're a little, little man. You got too much courage.
No, my friend, that's not what he owes me. It's not too much religion that he owes me. It's good religion. It's time to make me love God, love Jesus, and believe the book. Now, I may be a little, little old man, but my feet's on the solid rock. Amen. Praise God. I like that. Then shall that wicked one be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume. Now watch that. Whom the Lord shall consume with the brightness, with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. Now that's a reference to Revelation 19, and that's exactly the same terminology that you find in Revelation 19 when Jesus comes at the Battle of Armageddon. The very first two people that Jesus is going to put his hand on when he comes at the Battle of Armageddon is this burning wicked one and the fourth prophet. And the Lord's going to get one by the nape of the neck and the other one by the nape of the neck and put them in the lake of fire. Not in the bottom of the pit. He's going to put them in the lake of fire. He's going to put the devil in the bottom of the pit at the beginning of the millennium, but he's going to put the beast and the false prophet in the lake of fire. They're the first two to go to the lake of fire. He's going to destroy them by the brightness of his appearance and by the word of his mouth. Whom the Lord shall destroy, whom the Lord shall destroy, devil. Get his Antichrist all fixed up. He thinks he's about to win the battle. And he's about to go to hell. That's what he's about to do. He's not about to win the battle. God's got the battle already figured out. God's got the battle already won. In fact, Jesus won the battle when he walked out of the grave. 2,000 years ago, he won the battle that moment. The time is gone, but let me read another verse. Verse 9. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivement, and them that perish because they believe, love not the truth, that they might be saved. Now in the tribulation period, for this cause God shall send in the tribulation period a strong delusion. And that strong delusion is not for the church in our day, which is a tribulation verse, that they should believe a lie. And the lie we're going to believe in the tribulation is that the Antichrist is to be destroyed by Jesus at his revelation. That the Antichrist is the real Messiah. This world is given a strong delusion and they're going to believe that. What a sad thing. Sad thing indeed.